Good evening, church. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Can you guys hear me? Everybody? Praise God. It's good to be together, right? You know, we, before the church service started, we, with the band and preachers, we got together in the church office just to pray. And we noticed that we haven't been in that church office to do that for 3 months. It's great that we can be together again. And we all come together for one purpose, and one purpose only, is through worship, through sermon, to hear the Word of God. I'd like to share a little story from 1 Samuel. Samuel, as he was a young boy, he didn't know the voice of God. And remember when God was calling him, Samuel, Samuel, he would run up to Elijah and ask him, "Why are you calling me?" And he's like, "I never called you." And then he understood that it's God who's trying to speak to him. And here's what how he taught Samuel how to receive God's word. He said, "Go lie down, and it shall be, if he who calls you must speak again, say, 'Speak, Lord, for your servant hears.'" It requires something from us. In order to hear God's message today, we need to say these words: "Speak, Lord, for your servant hears." Now, we will go into the worship. I would like all of us to stand up right now. And the first song that we're going to sing is going to be called Oceans. I'm sorry, Rooftops, right? Thank you. Rooftops. That song, if you look at the lyrics, that song is just like a prayer. So before we start singing, or before we do anything, when you're going to be singing this song, I want you to sing it, not just a regular worship song, but sing it like you pray. Sing it like you pray. Rooftops.
Here I am before you, Father.
Our Heavenly Father, in this church service, we would like to lift our hands up and give you praise that you had all the glory in heaven, but yet you came down to this earth for the sinner like me, for the sinner like every one of us, to die for us. You gave up everything for us. We just want to say thank you because you're worthy of praise. Please help our hearts right now focus on you. Please help us sing this praise to you and understand that you deserve this. None of us wouldn't be here without your grace and mercy. Thank you so much for helping us out every single day to get up and be in your presence. All glory to you, my God. Amen.
God, let your glory go on and on. praise will always be on my lips. I will glory in the Lord. Let the afflicted hear and rejoice. Glorify the Lord with me. Let us exalt his name together. Amen. Let us sing.
Sing glorious sound. be here together, God. I want to thank you that we can all be this family and we could all be in the body of Christ, Lord. Lord, I pray that in this next song, every person that's here, every heart will open up and we could glorify your name forever because you deserve all the glory and all the praise, Lord. Thank you for loving us and thank you that we could be one in you, that you protect us and that you love us. Amen.
Grace abounds in deepest waters.
Come on, church, let's say it louder. Praise God.
Praise God.
You guys all may be seated. Thank you, worship it. I can only hear Slavik Ivanov saying praise God again. Slavik, чуть-чуть тише надо говорить. So everybody else can say it. Well, it's time for the announcements. Can we get some lights in the zone? Oh, wow, it's a lot of people. Praise God. Time for some announcements, and then we're going to turn back to our preachers and hear from God. So, Thursday, 7 o'clock, if you'd like to have a fellowship together, come through. We will have a soul lounge. We're not allowed to have soul lounge today, but if you want to hang out, meet with your Bible study group, you're more than welcome to come on Thursday at 7 o'clock, 7 to 10. Who was there last Thursday? Last Thursday, people? Yes, did you guys love it? It was great. A lot of singing, a lot of praising, a lot of kartoshka, volleyball kartoshka kind of thing. It was great. Good times. Next Sunday, we will have a last sermon in our sermon series, Lost Connection. And the topic is going to be hard questions of 1 John. Next Sunday, we will be talking about Antichrist, how John presenting Antichrist. Next Sunday, we will be talking about how we as Christians, we're not supposed to sin. We're all sinning, right? But John says, if you sin, then you're not born again. So it's a little confusion. And Pastor Vadim is going to be explaining those hard topics. Also, the last verse in that letter, 1 John, is very interesting. He is not finishing his letter with grace. He's finishing it with something else. And you guys will be hearing about it next Sunday. Also, registration for Sunday evening service opens up tomorrow night. So if you want to come for next Sunday evening service, register tomorrow, because prices are going to go nowhere. The seats are going to go somewhere, but the price is going to stay the same. $0 to come and fellowship together, worship together, and hear God's message. You guys are ready? All right, great. So take over.
Good evening, brothers and sisters. It's great to be with you guys tonight again as we're going through the series of Lost Connections, our study through 1 John. We've decided to try something kind of new. So this is the first time for us having three people on stage. We're all going to be focusing on the passage of 1 John chapter 2, verse 15 through 17. So if you guys want to open up with that with us. And remember, this is the first time. So if we mess this up, you have nothing to compare it to. So it's the best one we've had yet. So there we go. Please open up, like I said again, 1 John chapter 2, verse 15 through 17. Me, Daniel, Alex, and Boggy, we're each going to focus on an individual passage from this section. Originally, I thought that it's kind of strange. Like, there's only three verses, and each of us are preaching a topic on one of the verses. But then as I studied it and went into it a little bit more deeply, I was really confused by these passages. I feel like we can do a whole sermon series on just each individual one of these verses. So again, I'm going to start reading off from verse 15. 1 John chapter 2, verse 15. Do not love the world, nor the things in the world. If anyone loves the world, the love of the Father is not in him. For all that is in the world, the lust of the flesh, and the lust of the eyes, and the boastfulness, pride of life, is not from the Father, but is from the world. The world is passing away, and also its lusts, but the one who does the will of God lives forever. And we've probably read 1 John a bunch of times, especially because it's so short, so we made sure to read it real quick. But I want to focus on one specific verse from here, verse 16. For all that is in the world, the lust of the flesh, for all that is in the world, the lust of the flesh and the lust of the eyes and the boastful pride of life is not from the Father, but is from the world. Now, of course, we all say amen. That makes sense. But to me, this is actually really, really confusing. I can't those words don't make sense in my mind. And actually, for my point, I had to use a whiteboard. As I was studying for this passage, I had to write it out and just look at this verse. For all that is in the world, the lust of the flesh and the lust of the eyes and the boastful pride of life is not from the Father, but is from the world. So for me, the first thing that automatically stood out is 3 points. And we were actually going to do a sermon series on these, or preach 3 different things from these points. But I'm glad we didn't. So, the lust of the flesh, the lust of the eyes, and the boastful pride of life. And then I wrote him here again. That sounds weird. Like, that doesn't make sense to me, because when we hear the word lust, we automatically, excuse my French, but we automatically think something sexual. That in today's common English language, that word isn't a very pretty word. And doing some more research, I realized that we can cross that word out and just write desire. It still makes sense, because we're focusing on kind of, this verse is talking about the bad things of this world. It's talking about lust, and lust is a bad thing. But it's also talking about all kinds of desires that we have. So if we read this verse again, for all that is in the world, the desire of the flesh and the desire of the eyes and the pride of life is not from the Father, but is from the world. Written out like that, we kind of have to maybe dive deep and see like what these 3 things are. Because at first I thought like, wow, that's kind of cool. Like, that's probably somewhere out there in the world. I don't know like how I can get a stretch to that. I don't know how I can relate that to you guys. But as I'm reading this, I'm not sure if I understand these passages. And I listened to some really good sermons, and it actually wasn't even about this topic. It was about how the whole entire world, not the world that of social media. I don't know if you guys are alive in the 21st century, but most of us have a cell phone and most of us have social media. If you don't have social media, God bless you. I'm glad you can do that. I can't do that. But social media and just like marketing itself, they desire to attack these things of you. They want to go after your flesh. They want to go after your emotions. Like, their social media and like marketing, they're always like, you feel like doing something, go out and do it. Or do what makes you feel good. I don't know if you guys know this, but we live in a very sinful world that's full of very inappropriate images on the internet that a lot of young men and older men as well, they struggle with. And America, a very large portion of America's economy is from that. And that's actually very, very like sad and difficult that the world, as we're trying to live in it and navigate it, it's trying to attack our flesh, and the world is kind of marketing off of our flesh and our weaknesses. And they're getting a lot of money from it. And America's economy, they're actually from the porn industry is like a couple $1 billion a year. And that's all going into America's budget. And they're getting taxes from that. So the government isn't trying to stop it because they get a lot of money from it. So they're not complaining. And we don't even have to think of something as like graphic and explicit as that. If we even just do something as simple as like hunger. In marketing right now, if you're hungry, you can get Chipotle delivered to your house within 30 minutes. Like, that's a good thing. I don't know. That's a little bit more positive side of my message. But it's still necessarily the same thing. It's media and culture and marketing. They're saying that you have this desire right now in this exact moment. You can get it right here, right now. And that's kind of the craftiness of the world, that they get you on that. It's like we have a single emotion and bang, like you can get it right here, right now. And then another thing that all of that's in the world is the desire of the eyes. Excuse me.
I always thought that kind of desire of the flesh and the desire of the eyes, they were the same thing. But again, looking back at my life and just studying up on this, I'm a photographer. If a lot of you guys don't know that, if you do, follow me on Instagram. But even in like the whole Instagram trend and Pinterest trend, I'll be honest with you guys, a lot of those photos don't look like that in real life. People don't look like that. I'm a photographer. People ask me to take away pimples or to add a little bit more volume to the hair or something like that. So if I'm attributing to this, sorry. But we live in a world where that's almost one of the marketing values, where they're trying to, something looks shiny, and then they're going to sell that to you. And that's kind of how our eyes get enticed by that. And then it's also a sense of like, let's use just like a car commercial or something like that. They're coming out with a completely new vehicle, like Honda, something simple like that. Within 4 years, the Honda looks nothing like it used to look like 4 years ago. And then the commercials are going to try and advertise you the new car every single year, so you would give them your money. And of course, they use these supermodels. They use these people who look way too good. That's not real life. But they're always trying to make you feel like, oh, I want that. I can have that. And then you get this little thought in your mind that like, ooh, that looks good. And then through that, you kind of go down a rabbit trail in your mind, where you start thinking, ooh, that looks good. And at that moment, the marketing world and social media, they got you hooked. And then you want more, and then you want more, and then you see more, and then you want more of that. Like, I already used the example of my Photoshop skills. Sorry, I know I'm contributing to that. But I also know friends who, they literally buy things off of eBay, and they take a really good photo of it and just sell it. They'll sell it for a higher price. In fact, some car companies, or not car companies, car dismantling companies. That's the guys who take pictures of cars, and then they sell the car parts. What they'll do is they'll take a really, really, really nice photo. So then when you're going on eBay or like on Instagram or let's like even Craigslist or Facebook Marketplace, you're not going to buy the one that's an ugly photo. You're going to buy the one that's really shiny and really pretty. And it doesn't mean that the product works better. It just means it looks better. And we kind of, as human beings, we have this flaw of we jump on that. And then we just want the newer thing. We want the prettier thing. And then kind of the last thing, and let's see. This is pride. The pride of life is kind of, to me, in my NASB Bible, that sounds a little confusing. So I want us, when you read this, just read it as just pride, as pride. So in the marketing world and in social media, people try and make you feel like you're more important than you are. And not saying you're not important. I'm just saying that when companies sell stuff to you, they want to make you feel as important as possible. Like Burger King, something simple. Burger King's motto is have it your way. The customer's always right, that kind of mentality. Oh, and then even Chick-fil-A, our beloved Chick-fil-A, they're always saying my pleasure, like it's their honor to serve you. Just these simple things, like we don't even realize that it's happening all the time, but people say it, and then our pride goes up in ourselves, and then we're sold on that item. I used to work at Best Buy for like 3 months, one of the only real jobs I ever had. And one thing that one of my coworkers would do is he would always say, oh, thanks, boss, or I got that for you, boss, like to random customers. They would say, thank you, boss, and just stuff like that, like a really elevating status. Like, biblically wise, that would be the example, the same as saying, oh, my Lord, thank you, my Lord, thank you. Just like really elevating the customer and making the customer think that they're important. And that dude was the one who got the most sales because he made the customer feel most valued, most important. Like he raised his social status in his mind, so he bought it from him. And it's these slight little tricks that we have it's these little things that are wrong with us that aren't necessarily wrong at their core, but if the evil desires of this world, if they get into that and they get hooked into that, then we're kind of just lost. It's going to go down a crazy spiral. We live in a world that things are always changing. So like then, even all of these marketing things that people use, they're always trying something new. Like probably of us sitting here during this sermon, one of our apps probably got like an update. It's just saying that like, oh, here's a new update, something new. And there's always going to be a sense of we start here and then something better comes around. So we jump to that. But then as we're here, something better comes around and then we jump to that. So in today's society, we're always getting a cycle of we see something better and then we go to that. We see something better, we go to that. That's why phones are always like, I have an iPhone 10 and to me, that's like my favorite phone ever. But then even since the iPhone 10, there's so many new ones. I believe there's iPhone XS, then there's iPhone 11, I don't know. There's the iPhone Pros and stuff like that. And to me, it's a level of here's something new, here's something new, here's something shiny. It can make your life better. And they're not necessarily bad things at the core. I want to remind you guys of that. But then the world will trick us into that. And then if we put all of our life's ambitions and life's desires into these categories, we're just going to get lost in this world. If we're, our whole life purpose is going to have the best job and we're going to want to have to be the CEO of a company, then in a few years there's going to be someone newer who comes and they're going to replace us. If our life is just to have our flesh fulfilled, just to have the desires of our flesh fulfilled, then we're eventually just going to get tired of it and we're going to get burnt out. If it's something of our eyes, if we're desiring something that looks shiny, dude, guys, like every 6 months new clothing comes out. And then the clothing that was cool 6 months ago, it's no longer cool. And it's just this constant cycle of, I said that, there's always something better. There's always something better. There's always something better. And we're going to get stuck in this constant loop of what's next? What's new? What's new? And I want to ask us, do we find joy in these things? Do we find pride in these things? Is it our whole life's goal and passion for these things? Because if we get stuck in the loop, we're either going to be permanently stuck in the loop or we're never going to be satisfied. We're never going to be fulfilled. We're going to love this world and love the things in this world, but they're never going to fully satisfy. We're always going to get stuck. There's always going to be something new that comes around. And I want you guys to remember that the desire of the flesh, the desire of the eyes, and pride, they're not from the Father. They're not from God. So if that's your life purpose and your whole purpose in life is one of these three things, really check yourself. Check your life. Make sure you're not going down this spiral and you're getting stuck. I want to bring up a point without getting too political, but unfortunately, I can't. So one quick second. This. So, if you know what this is, follow along. If you don't know what this is, God bless your soul. We live in a world where hashtag love wins, where the world's definition of love is whatever you want it to be. Kind of like the desire of the flesh. It's, you feel like this is your definition of love, go out and do it. No one's stopping you. You can't stop them. In fact, if we try and tell someone that what they're doing is wrong, we can get sued for it, and then no one wants to get sued. This is what the world said about love, and they're saying love wins. Now, a couple years after this movement started, there's a whole bunch of new letters added to this movement. What these letters mean, I unfortunately do not really care, and I do not care to inform you guys. But this movement, they've been just, like 6 years ago, it was just these four things. And then they're like, someone comes around and says, well, this thing is love. So then they add another definition of love. And then they add a new thing, a new thing, a new thing. And this is kind of terrifying to see where the world is going to end up being in like 20 years from now. We live in a culture where it's, you feel like doing something, go out and do it. You feel like this is love, this is your pursuit, this is your passion, go out and do it. And this is a real extreme example of that. And I'm just, let's go back to something simpler like Chipotle. If we're in a culture, in a society, we're in a world where it's, they're trying to capitalize on our weaknesses. And it's just a constant state of what's next, what's next, what's next. And I just want us to kind of look back and think in our lives, if the world is not sure what the definition of love is, if the world has a skewed imagination of love, and love has to change every 6 months and something new, what do we do in this world? How are we supposed to survive?
Now we know what the world wants from us, or what to expect from the world. What's next? I'm going to be focused on the other side of what God has to offer, not what the world has to offer. Continuing reading, Daniel started from 1 John chapter 2, verse 16. I'm going to go back one verse, and we're going to be focused on verse 15. So let's read that verse. Love not the world, neither the things that are in the world. If any man loves the world, the love of the Father is not in them. Now, when preparing for this sermon and reading this verse I was given, there were a few questions that came into my head to how the best way I could do is to explain what this means, fully understand it completely. And yeah, I don't fully understand what Father's love is, because that's what it's talking about, the love of the Father. I'm going to try to explain it as best as I can. So as I prayed and was preparing for this, like usually everything else, when I have homework or I have a project due, I asked the smartest person I know, and I Googled it, and it came up with 8 answers, basically, of what that verse means. So starting off, let's read. Starting off with the first question. So there were 3 questions that came up with. I was able to come up with 3 questions which describe this verse. The first question is, what's Father's love? That's what I'm going to be focused on my first point. Second is, what is the difference between Father's love and the world's love? And finally, why is it important to have Father's love in us? So starting off, I Googled what is Father's love, and the first answer in Greek, we all know that there's 8 different points of love. First one's eros, romantic love. Second's philia, affection love, it's friendship love. Second one, it's storge, it's family member love, it's love of the family. And ludus is the 4th one, playful love, pragma, enduring love. Philadelphia, I don't know how to pronounce that, self-love, mania, obsessive love, and finally the 8th one is agape, selfless love. So there are 8 different loves, different types of love in the, that I found out. And it got me very curious to see which of these types of love is written in that text. So when I did further research, it turns out that agape is the form of love that is written in this text. So it's selfless love. So this is Father's love, selfless love. So now that's what the internet says, that it's selfless love. And let's open up to the Bible to see what the Bible says about this certain love, agape. It's focused on agape. In 1 Corinthians chapter 13, verses 1 through 8, we will read, if I speak in tongues of men or of angels, but do not have love, I am only a resounding gong or a clanging cymbal. If I have the gift of prophecy and can fathom all mysteries and all knowledge, and if I have a faith that can move mountains, but do not have love, I am nothing. If I give all I possess to the poor and give over my body to hardships that I must boast, but do not have love, I gain nothing. Love is patient. Love is kind. It does not envy. It does not boast. It is not proud. It does not dishonor others. It is not self-seeking. It is not easily angered. It keeps no record of wrongs. Love does not delight in evil, but rejoices with the truth. It always protects, always trusts, always hopes, always preserves. Love never fails. As we read this text, we could have a better point of view or perspective of the main definition of what's going on here in the text, in 1 John chapter 2, verse 15. Love not the world, neither the things that are in the world. If any man loves the world, the love of the Father is not in them. So that's what Father's love is. It's the love of the Father. It never fails. Even when we fall down, turn away from the righteous path, do wrong deeds, no matter what it is, if we ask for forgiveness, our Father will always love us and be there for us. A very good example of that is a story from the Bible. I'm not going to read it off to you. You guys probably know it. It's very popular. It's book of Luke, chapter 15, verses 11 through 22. It's about, it's also Jesus is giving a good example of Father's love in that situation. It's about a lost son. So I'm going to give you a quick recap about that story. I'm not going to read it off. It's about a father that had two sons. One of them decided that he wants to go on adventure, go live his own life, which is a good comparison to us. Sometimes we want to go into the world, like Daniel said. There's a lot of things that it has to offer. So he got his part that his dad gave him. Of money, wealth, what it was, and he went and he spent everything. And it got so bad that he wasted everything, hunger came, and he became a worker, that he was feeding the pigs, and even the pigs, it's written that he desired the food that the pigs ate. He didn't even have that. And he started thinking, like, how did I fall down, you know, so much? It's like, I have a dad that is very wealthy. Maybe I could go to him and become, you know, slave for him, and maybe he'll accept me back. And that's the exactly same love that our Father Jesus Christ gives us. It's the exact, like, he'll accept us right away, because when he was heading there, he made few steps towards Jesus Christ, or for the Father, his Father's directions towards the house. He already saw him from the distance, and he got so excited. He came, welcomed him, hugged him, and when he begged for forgiveness, he didn't make him, you know, a slave, even though that's what he deserved. He went and wasted a lot of money, and he came back, like, with nothing to become a slave, but he put him back into his position. He called him his son, gave him best clothes, made a whole feast for him. That's basically what, I guess, one of the Father's love is. That's what it is in a good example. So the second question that we're going to be focused on when we read 1 John chapter 2, 15, we found out what Father's love is, but it also says, love not the world, neither the things that are in the world. If any man loves the world, the love of the Father is not in them. So we're going to be focused on the love of the world. Now we know what Daniel spoke a lot about the world, what it has to offer, and now we know what God's love is. But what's the difference between Father's love and the world's love? So let's read 1 Timothy chapter 6, verses 7 through 10. So 1 Timothy chapter 6, verses 7 through 10. For we brought nothing into the world, and we can take nothing out of it. But if we have food and clothing, we will be content with that. Those who want to get rich fall into temptation and a trap, and into many foolish and harmful desires that plunge people into ruin and destruction. For the love of money is a root of all kinds of evil. Some people agree for money, eager for money, have wandered from the faith and pierced of evil. Some people themselves with many griefs. It is not bad to want things. Like Daniel has spoke about a lot of bad things that the world has to offer to us. But I would like to focus on some things like how about a high-paying job, good car, wealthy house, have a better physical appearance, all these things that I know that a lot of us might desire. But these are not bad things to desire. Like, it's pretty good to be healthy, fit, to go to the gym and all that. But if you guys are going to make it your priority or, you know, going to give a lot of time to it to get yourself a good car, even though you might not, you know, you're paying high bills, you're barely keeping up, you know, to have it, and you put all your effort into it, that's actually a sin. That's not the right thing to do. So that's basically what the difference between father's love. It's the things that are temporary in our life. The world, that all these luxury things that we have or that we want, physical appearance, luxury, watches, cars, mansions, whatever we desire. It's not bad to desire those things. I mean, if you guys could have that, I mean, God bless you and all. I mean, it'd be great to have friends like you guys having all those things. But, I mean, if you're going to focus all your energy, not go to church, like, not be active in church is what I mean. If you put all of your priority to that, that's what makes it a sin. So that's one of the reasons that's one of the things that the world offers to us. And if we're going to put too much time to it, that's what it is. And also, I would like to put that, I said that God's love, it's eternal. While these luxury things that we have, it's temporary. So, for example, like fleshly desires, let's say, like marriage, people that want to get married or they already got married, a few years might pass by and you just might not wake up one day and like, oh, I don't love her or him anymore. You don't love your spouse. It's just emotions, you know? It's something that passes, or maybe it doesn't. It doesn't have to be a marriage. It has to be anything. It doesn't matter what it is, but the system of the world, it says it's okay to get a divorce. It's okay to go and, you know, to do abortions. It's okay to do that. If you were not ready, it's okay. You know, that's the system of the world. They make us more comfortable, like Daniel said. Anything for you. That's world's love. They give you all these pleasures, but they're temporary pleasures. Unlike God's love, when he gives you his love, you're fulfilled for eternally. You have goals that you want to reach, and our goal is heaven. So like Jesus Christ, when we sin, he didn't say, since they're sin and they're so bad, I'm not going to go looking for a different bride. He keeps working with us. He, like in John 3:16, Jesus, he died for our sins even before he knew us personally. Before we were good, before we became Christian, he already, you know, he paid for who we were when we were sinners. So that's the difference. God's love is not circumstantial. God loves us for who we truly are. And unlike the world's love, God loves has a foundation. And that foundation is Jesus Christ. Now, moving to the third point, what does it mean to have Father's love? And why is it important? Why is it important for us to have Father's love? Because once again, I'm going to read the verse 15 from 1 John, verse 15. Love not the world, neither the things that are in the world. If any man loves the world, the love of the Father is not in them. It is very important for us in this verse. We see that it's very important to have that Father's love that he gives us. Now, as we dig deeper, let's open up and read Luke chapter 6, verses 31 through 34. Treat others in the same way that you would want them to treat you. If you love those who love you, what credit is that to you? For even sinners love those who love them. And if you do good to those who do good to you, what credit is that to you? Even sinners do the same. And if you lend to those from whom you hope to be repaid, what credit is that to you? Even sinners lend to sinners, so that they may be repaid. What credit is that to them? So, in this passage, we need to be different from this world. It shows that we need to be very different from how other people act. It's showing that even sinners, they act, they do everything for their benefit. But once we have Father's love, we're not going to be doing that for their benefit. We're going to be doing that because we have Father's love in them. So, as I want to also read another passage from 1 John verses chapter 4, verses 8 through 16. Whoever does not love does not know God, because God is love. This is how God showed his love among us. He sent his one and only Son into the world that we might live through him. Not that we loved God, but that he loved us and sent his Son as atoning sacrifice for our sins. Dear friends, since God so loved us, we also ought to love one another. No one has ever seen God, but if we love one another, God lives in us and his love made complete in us. This is how we know that we live in him and he lives in us. He has given us his Spirit, and we have seen and testified that the Father has sent his Son to be the Savior of the world. If anyone acknowledges that Jesus Christ is the Son of God, God lives in them, and they in him. So the point of this is that it's our obligation as Christians to show love to others. It is the will of God as well. It's also the will of God for us to love our neighbor, anybody that, everybody that we know or who we don't know. It might sound nice in theory, but if you actually think about that one person or maybe multiple people that, like, you're not friends with or your enemies, I don't know how you want to call them. Like, imagine, like, the things that they do to you and maybe you feel that it's so unfair, but you have to forgive them. I mean, if you're going to really think about it, like, why should I forgive him? I'm innocent, and there's nothing I did wrong. Or in real life, when you have these kind of situations, you understand that it's very hard and sometimes even impossible to forgive. But, like, okay, I might forgive, but love them and give them something that they do not deserve? That's a whole different, meaning to it. But Jesus Christ says that's his will. That's what he gives us every day. That's what he did for us. And he's saying, since I did that for you, and he filled us with his Spirit, with his love, he's like, please spread that to others. And also, this is one of the ways that we as Christians could spread the gospel to other people in this world. So in conclusion, just to summarize this verse from 1 John chapter 2, verse 15, there were three questions to answer the meaning of this verse. The first one was, what is Father's love? And Father's love is selfless, sacrificial. It is unconditional love that is bigger than our understanding. Second question was, what's the difference between Father's love and the world's love? Father's love is not circumstantial. God loves us for who we truly are. And unlike the world's love, God's love is eternal. And it has a foundation, which is Jesus Christ. It doesn't end. It's not temporary. And third question was, what does it mean to have Father's love? Why is it important? And it's important to have Father's love because it is what separates us from this world. That's how they see that we are different. We're not part of this world. And it's also how we spread further the love that God gives us.
Section. So keep it brief, keep it straight to the point. Let's go. What does the world have to offer us? I'm going to do a super brief recap, just my thoughts. Daniel gave some examples. I feel like it'd be wrong if I didn't have an opportunity to share mine, and no one's stopping me other than time. So first point, lust of flesh. What does that mean? It's I do what I want. I am the most important person. I do what makes me feel good. My feelings, 21st century, very important. My feelings. You think what you want, but I feel this way, right? And if you think about it logistically, like, what is stopping you from doing what you want? If you still live with your parents, maybe a curfew. You know, that's what's holding you back. Otherwise, the law? What about, you know, once you're at your parents' house and you have disregard for law? You're just doing what you want. But we know this is the world and it's really all messed up. Lust of the eyes. I want what looks good, the shiny, the attractive. And it kind of ties to the first one. I want what looks good. Hopefully that thing makes me feel good. And I want things that brings pleasure to me. The third one, the pride of life. I'm the most important person. This one,
I feel like especially for men, it's a real struggle point, because every single guy here, you can't lie to me. I know you want to be respected. Not saying the ladies don't, but for guys, that's very important. Gontar, back me up. He gave me the A-OK. Respect is very important for guys, because, you know, we're the head of the household, we're this and that. We want to achieve things. We want people to recognize us for that. Lately, I've been really into watching, like, boxing documentaries, and Julia's like, what's up with that? And I'm like, I don't really know, but they're kind of fun. And I was watching one about Lomachenko, and go Ukraine, national hero, super cool guy. He's friends with Usyk. That's a whole other story. Lomachenko, he's a very interesting person, but one of the things he was talking about is when he was still an amateur, he was training for his first Olympic Games. Ever since he was 10, he was working towards that goal. And sure enough, in 2012, in London, he wins gold. And he shares about this. And he said, as they were putting this medal on my chest, he said, what now? It's kind of disappointing. You achieved the highest thing you can achieve is an Olympic gold medal. And he felt disappointment because he didn't know what was next. He was working towards one goal. I mean, he went on to get another gold medal and multiple belts and stuff. But what I'm getting at from this point, from Lomachenko's story, is achieving physical things, achieving awards, it doesn't bring satisfaction to our souls. So that's what the world's offering us. Daniel made a great case. I hate the world, right? But we don't. Sanyo's talking about what God's offering us. And what were three things you say God is offering us? First and foremost, salvation. God, through Jesus, gave us the solution to probably the biggest problem of all time. That's the problem of sin, right? And we now have an opportunity to be reconciled with God. And quick aside, I really want to mention this, put it, you know, hammer on the head. When we talk about salvation, and someone has given me some feedback on this, at our church, we try to focus on the fact that, you know, ministries are important. We want to focus on, you know, good deeds, love towards our neighbor. Those are great. But the equation for salvation is just one thing. It's Jesus plus nothing equals salvation. Jesus alone gets us to salvation. It's not your works. It's not your ministries. It's nothing like that. It's all about Jesus. Second thing that God is offering us, a little bit controversial, but backed up by Daniel Gontar, who's the great theologian, we get a better life on earth with Jesus. Once you accept Jesus in your heart, your life changes for the better. Now, once you accept Jesus, your bank account doesn't go up. It might. Once you get invite Jesus into your life, you don't instantly find a wife or a husband. You might. But the point is, one does not lead to the other. Your life doesn't get better, but your view of life gets better. Does that make sense? Thank you for that nod. Once you accept Jesus into your life, you receive the Holy Spirit. He walks with you. He guides you through life. And essentially, he guides you towards the one goal. And that is the third point, is Jesus offers us, or God is offering us, heaven. And that's a very long introduction to the 17th verse of that passage that we're going through today. And I'm just going to read it real quick in case you forgot. 1 John chapter 2, verse 17. And the world is passing away along with its desires, but whoever does the will of God abides forever. I want to focus on the last portion there. Whoever does the will of God abides forever. Now, I don't have to explain to you how long forever is, but if there is that one person, forever is eternity. And forever and eternity, I really want to sell you on this cool place. It's called heaven. As I was preparing this, I asked quite a few people, and I want to ask you now, take a moment, don't rush, it's a pretty serious question. Why do you want to go to heaven? I don't want the textbook answer. I want you to just actually think about it for a moment, and I'm going to take a longer pause than that one. Why do you want to go to heaven? I got a few answers. Some of them I agreed with. Some of them, they're probably wrong, but I saw where they were coming from. A lot of us don't want to go to heaven just yet. We have things to achieve. But those that, you know, they knew it, they said these things. They said, I want to go to heaven because Jesus is there. I want to go there. I want to see him. I want to thank him for what he did for me. Once we're born again, we have a new goal. None of those things, none of the things I mentioned. We have a new goal. We're working towards something different. We have a new desire. We have something much bigger we're striving for. Someone gave me an example that, you know, if you're ever away on a business trip, if you're ever away from home, you might be staying in a nice place. I wish. You might be getting a rental car. That's a convertible. And you're having a great time, and it's fun. But you're not home. You still miss home. You miss what's at home. Who's at home? And that's similar to life. We're here for a period of time. You're at the business trip for a weekend. Or, no, opposite. During the weekday, you're there, right? Or a week, work week. And then you have to go back to where you're going to be permanently. And I hope that's heaven. One more thing before I continue on. One sign or one indicator of a reborn Christian is that your desires shift. They change. You want to go home. You want to achieve things here, you know, for your family, for your friends, for your church. I don't know what your goal is. You still want to achieve things here, but your long-term goal, your bigger goal, you want to go home. And heaven is, it's not about us. Heaven is great. There's not going to be any sickness. There's not going to be any death. There will be no night, from what I heard. But more, that's for us. But most importantly, heaven's all about God. We're just going to go and hang out for eternity with God, praising him, and so on. To wrap this all up, I'm going to take you back to the early 1920s, the roaring 20s. A lot of change is going on. More people were moving from the country to the cities. A lot of cultures are mixing. Huge boom in the economy, consumer market. Hottest technology ever, home radios. You can listen to the baseball game. I'm excited. The Ford Model T was the coolest car. It was the first car mass produced. It costs you $260 total, not per month if you're leasing a Ford Fusion, right? Total. Racial tension was on a rise. Black culture was creeping into the cities from the South. You had all the other immigrants. There's a huge anti-communism swing going on. And I was reading this, and I'm like, it's 2020, 100 years, 100 years. How much has changed, right? Instead of that TV, newest iPhone. Instead of that Model T, it's the Model Y, right? Still racial tension, ongoing, same thing. Communism, it's making a comeback. People actually like that thing now. But it's weird, but we've come in a full circle. People, the items, the specific things or the ideas are changing, but the big picture is the same. We want that new thing. 100 years has passed, and the only thing I want to focus on is those people that were around in the 1920s. I hope that some of them knew Jesus, because if you're unless you live to be past 100, you're probably dead, right? And whatever they might have achieved in their life, they might have got that car. Instead of the Model T, they got the better one, the premium version. And they drove around it, and everyone without a car looked at them with desire. But that car died. They died, the people. And now they're in eternity, one of two places. Believers are not immune to the offers of the world, right? We still want things. But believers actually stumble often. But the only difference is they hate sin. They hate these desires, and they're trying to combat them. Christians have a bigger goal. They want something bigger. They're attracted to something bigger. And fortunately for us, Christ is enough. God is enough. That's what we strive for. So as I'm finally closing, believer, if you put yourself in that category, has something that we've mentioned off the stage tonight, has it convicted you? Which desire of the world is most attractive to you? Is it a category? Is it one specific item that you have your mind set on that's very important to you? Are you attracted more to eternity in heaven with God? Or are you more attracted to a house, a wife, a 401k? What is it for you? And then if you haven't accepted Jesus yet, have the desires that you've been trying to fill your soul with, have they pleased you? Were they able to satisfy that deep, empty feeling from within? God wants to offer you so much more in his son Jesus. He wants a personal relationship with you. And that relationship extends past this life, past everything on this earth. Let's all stand. We're going to pray. Whoever would like to pray, and then I'll finish. Lord God, we stand before you today, and we acknowledge that we are all sinners, that we all have these desires on this earth, that we all want to achieve all these things that bring us pleasure, that make us feel good, things that look good, that make us look good in front of others. Lord, I pray that tonight that I myself and everyone here, that we get a slight better understanding of who you are and what you're offering us, who you're offering us. Lord, that we can accept Jesus into our hearts. We can treasure him more, what he's done for us, and that we can see the bigger picture, that eternity with heaven, in heaven with you is the ultimate goal. Bless us for the remainder of this evening. All these things are praying in your name. Amen.
We heard a great message, and we hope to see you guys next Sunday evening. Please come by to our soul lounge on Thursday at 7 o'clock, and please tomorrow register to come next Sunday evening. See you guys then. Have a blessed week.
You give life, you are love, you bring light to the darkness, you give hope, you restore every heart that is broken. Great are you, Lord. You give life, you are love, you bring light to the darkness, you give hope, you restore every heart that is broken. So we sing.